The problem we just did was 305.
Okay.
It's
describe the cylindrical surface of a given equation.
Yeah.
Okay.
So we got that it's cosine. It's basically negative sine, but we got that. But the rulings.
Yeah.
Are they, since it, you're supposed to be able to slice it at any point, and it looks the same.
Well, like a moment ago, I saw two graphs here.
Right.
And what, at a glance, they look like curves.
Right.
And, but what they're asking you to graph here is not a curve.
See?
It's a surface.
Right. Okay.
See the difference?
Yes.
So what you were graphing was actually part of the surface, but not the surface itself.
Right. Because we had, well, as I was telling, because there was no X or no Z, no Y, that it continued off in that direction of yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, now that I think about it.
Yeah, so there's a big difference between a surface and a curve.
Right, okay.
Surface and a curve. A surface is a two-dimensional thing. It's like a sheet that kind of undulates.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas a curve is kind of like a string in space, kind of winding around. Could be straight, but
in intangible string in space.
Yeah.
Intangible. Not a wordographer.
Yeah.
Dictionary.
Over here with that book, bro.
Oh, bro, you sit over here, man. There you go. Just because I like to build my vernacular.
Which way?
It works, yeah.
I sheet my sword and the past is more shallow.
Look, you keep getting more right.
Gotcha.
Well, I thought I'd take a moment to see how we can use technology for three-dimensional graphing.
Oh, hey.
Yeah, it seems like pretty helpful.
Yeah.
In the book, it says use technology. Big old teams at it.
Now, I like Desmos, but it doesn't really, it's not really like, I imagine someday they'll start to implement it. They're always coming up with new implementations. They might have a way to do it in the future.
Okay.
You know, a simple way to do 3D graphing. But the nearest thing to it, I did come across something like this. It's kind of like making Desmos do something it's not really designed to do.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
You know what I mean? And if you look through this, there's a lot of like really fancy equations in here. And there's more than meets the eye if you look at. No, actually, that's all there. Lots of fancy equations. Actually, these are all coming from probably the next section we're going to cover, these equations, cylindrical and spherical coordinates. But it's nice because it's in the form of a function of x and y, right? So for example, in this particular example that you mentioned, right here, 305, z equals cosine of pi over 2 plus x.
Right.
But there is a y, it just doesn't appear in that equation.
Right.
Right? That's why it's a type of cylinder. But I'm going to regard z as a function of x and y. It's just that there's no y in it, right? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this function I see right here, I'm going to plug it in right there. See, I'm going to take away this function, right? We're going to use the cosine of pi over 2, what is it, plus x?
Plus x.
And you get this. I don't know if I can drag it. So what you can see is just that portion of it that's in the first octant.
Right.
And you can see how it intersects the xz plane, right, along this curve right here. You can see the curve right there. And I think I saw that on the board a moment ago. But that's why I said the surface, there's more to it than what I saw.
It goes on forever.
Yeah. So you want to render it in such a way so it's clear that you know that there's an actual surface here.
Right.
Usually 3D graphing programs will have like a way to change the perspective, know what I mean? So like, for example, A, B, and C to see what they do. So if I change A, I'm rotating around the Z-axis. Helps me to kind of see things a little. Helps me see some of the details I couldn't see at that particular perspective. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Or if I switch B, I'm kind of changing this angle right here so I can look at it from above,
that's very cool.
Even from underneath. That kind of is pretty nice. And C seems to be like a rotation.
A yaw. Pitch yaw.
There you go. Yeah, so this is a nice, it's actually implemented pretty nicely, you know? But yeah, so there's that. And I think that's a pretty nice option. You just have to like find this 3D graph using parametric, right? Mm-hmm. Parametric lines. You can use them, I think there's other things you can tinker with too, like the mesh in. So how many lines you want to have. So this and S is that kind of stuff. L, how long the lines are. Okay, that's cool. Anyway, lots of stuff you can do with that. Otherwise, I believe with Wolfram Alpha, right? Where is that? This one? I think you can do 3D graphs there too. This might be kind of tricky.
Desmos all the way.
Yeah. Let's see. If I say Z equals cosine of pi over 2 plus x, let's see what happens if I just type that in. Okay. So it's interpreting as a function of two variables with an x and a z-axis. Maybe I can, so it's not interpreting it as in being in three space. What if I say f of x comma y? Now it should be clearer to Wolfram Alpha that I'm thinking of a function of two variables. Okay, there we go. You see that right there? Mm-hmm. It's kind of the same idea. This is the x-axis. This is the y-axis, and this is the z-axis.
It's actually the picture in the book for the answer.
Oh yeah, maybe they use it.
Or we're close here. Yeah.
Yeah, and then right here, can you see that this is the same graph as that one?
By the shading.
Yeah.
The concentration.
So the shading, the color, is indicating the altitude, right?
Right, right.
Yeah. So you can kind of see how. So these vertical lines are the rulings.
So,
right?
Okay.
You can see the rulings going this way right there.
Right.
Right. Or if I switch back to here, you can see the rulings going this way.
Okay. Right. So they are perpendicular to the x axis.
I would say they're perpendicular to the x z plane.
X z plane.
Just want to make sure.
Technically, it's skew
to
the x-axis.
Well, parallel to the y.
Parallel to the y, yeah, you can say that.
Okay.
Yep. So these are a couple more resources that might be useful. All right.
Oh, okay. Looks like we got one. Hold on. I'm sorry, move. F of x, z. Equals cosine.
The video from yesterday is not posted yet.
Yeah, I got one of them up. The short, we went over the homework basically.
Yeah.
I still need to get the other ones up.
I'm not like rushing. I'm just asking. Is that correct?
Yeah, that's correct. It'll be on its way.
Oh, there you go, Miss Dingle.
Mm-hmm.
It's GeoGebra.
GeoGebra. Yeah. That's a good one. Is that like an app?
Yep.
Okay. Yeah, they have it for your computers as well. I think I have that. They're right there. Right there. See that one?
Yeah. That is exactly what I want.
GeoGebra. I've never actually tried it. I didn't know it had a smartphone application. So it has some pretty cool stuff. sometimes I'll use this to come up with graphics for like the tests and stuff.
But it's...
Well, then we'll use it to come up with the answers for the test.
But it's kind of, it's wrong though.
Yeah.
Because that's the same. That's the same.
I'm not sure if you can do
3D okay, it is.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's 3D.
Okay.
I can pivot it around.
Nice. Oh, that's nice. I'll have to look into that. I like it. Okay. Oh yeah, this one. Yeah, see this rendering definitely looks like that Mathematica sort of interface right here. Technically, see how the zeros in the middle, so they're showing a little bit of all the quadrants actually.
Yeah.
Octants. Okay. So the origin's actually in the middle of that box, right? Well, sort of. The origin is actually below the middle of the box because the z-axis, the zero from the z-axis is down there. So the origin's like down there, right? In that case. Yeah. Any other issues come up?
Man, this is a good idea. I should mark the blue code.
This is the third term of using that graph.
So the discussion for today will remind you of the discussion we had at the end of trigonometry.
Yay!
At the end of trigonometry, we were talking about graphing in polar coordinates. We saw that at the time, we were much more comfortable with rectangular coordinates where a particular point could be described with a...
Yes?
I'm sorry. Completely off topic. But as you speak to geometry and I saw the pi over 2 plus x, mm-hmm. I immediately went to cosine alpha plus bravo equals cosine alpha cosine bravo.
That's a good
minus
way to
sine alpha sine bravo.
Yeah.
But then I was like, x isn't an angle though.
It is.
See, that's what I thought.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, we didn't use the letter x, but because it appears as an argument of the cosine,
mm-hmm.
It you would interpret it as an angle,
as variable radians.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, yeah. I had a similar discussion with somebody else who's taking multivariable calculus right now over in, I think it was just today actually. But he was just, they were parameterizing, in three space. And he was really thrown off because there was a sine and a cosine, but of t. You know what I mean? It's like, and he didn't get really thrown off because it's like, you know, he's not used to thinking of t as an angle. And if they had used theta instead of t, I don't think he would have been as like thrown off.
Right.
You know
what
I mean? But you know, they're just letters of the alphabet, Greek or English. You know,
Greek or English. Yeah.
So yeah. But yeah, when we use rectangular coordinates, we're just speaking of this distance and that distance.
Excellent.
Yeah. Of course, thinking of it as a signed distance. Usually distance can't be negative, but you know, if this is a negative distance, I guess it's just down there, right? But that's rectangular coordinates. And then we started exploring different ways to describe a point. Instead of giving you an x and a y, I can give you an r and a theta.
I actually like this.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. And we arrived at several equations. We saw that x squared plus y squared equals r squared. And the tangent of theta is equal to y over x. And the skills we were practicing back then is, if I give you a x and a y, can you find r and theta? And vice versa. If I give you r and theta, can you give me x and y? Right? And you just gotta practice it. Well, that's not the discussion we had in the past. We're gonna have the same discussion, but in three space.
Because,
I mean, the difference is you have been working with x and y coordinates for a pretty long time, at least two or three quarters by then. I mean, we've been working on in x and y in three coordinates for maybe a week or two. You didn't get as much time to get acclimated to that, but and now all of a sudden we're switching to some different ways to describe our points. So but the way we've done it so far is I would specify a point in space, say like right here, and it would be described with three coordinates, the distance over here, distance over here, and the distance to get up to here. Which given those three distances.
Mm-hmm. So maybe I'm jumping it. But wouldn't the R then just be square root of XYZ squared? X squared plus Y. Because when we do
well, yeah, that's the, yeah, that's the distance magnitude.
So then all you really need is the angle, I guess.
Yeah. Well, there's different ways of doing it. Cool. We only had one alternative to the rectangular coordinates we had to call it. Here, we're going to have two alternatives.
Is there like three alternatives before space then?
I don't even know. I haven't gotten that far yet. But, you know, we're going to have... it'll be a little more comfy because here... You had to be able to work between, like I said before, if I give it to in rectangular coordinates, can you turn it into polar? And vice versa, if I give it to you in polar coordinates, can you give it to me in rectangular? Right? I haven't told you what cylindrical and spherical mean yet, but what we're going to be looking at is the rectangular coordinates, the cylindrical and spherical, and you'll need to practice six skills.
Shouldn't they not be called rectangular coordinates in three space? Should be like cubical coordinates?
Yeah, I guess that would kind of make sense.
It makes no difference.
Yeah.
Difference. Cartesian versus...
So you want to be able to, if I give it to you in rectangular, can you switch to cylindrical? And if I give it to you in cylindrical, can you go back to rectangular? Mm. Or if you're in rectangular, can you go to spherical and back and forth? Or just bypass rectangular altogether and go from cylindrical to spherical or spherical to cylindrical, right? That's going to be six different skills to practice in the homework. But the starting point is going to be, what is cylindrical coordinates? What I do with cylindrical coordinates is I specify an R, a theta, and a Z. It's a natural extension of polar coordinates. So, in other words, I'm going to, instead of giving you an x, a y, and a z in rectangular, I'll instead give you an r, a theta, and a z. That's in cylindrical. So R, by R, what do I mean? I mean this distance. Mm. By theta, I mean the angle in the xy plane from the positive x-axis, right there. So at this point, you can see how R and theta mean pretty much the same thing it did in polar coordinates. But the z here in cylindrical coordinates is the same as the z in rectangular coordinates. So instead of like going along here, and then up to get to the point, I just go directly to here and then straight up. Right? It's just another way of describing the same point. And then, if you were to do the same in spherical coordinates, I'm going to specify they use a certain order to make sure I say it in the same way. Spherical, rho theta phi. Rho, theta, and phi. this one's even more direct. Rho is a distance. It's the direct distance from the origin straight to the point, right? And theta is the same theta as we saw in cylindrical coordinates, right? But phi is the angle measured from the z-axis to that line segment.
So it seems like they should have did it from the from that line to just the xy plane.
Yeah, I guess you could have. But yeah, I think it works out. I think a lot of the math problems work out a little nicer this way. Yeah, especially since I'm trying to think of the most familiar sphere to us, which isn't actually a sphere, the planet Earth. You know what I mean? It's nearly a sphere, and lines of latitude, are they meant, is 0 degrees latitude, is that the equator or is that the North Pole?
Latitude is equator.
Equator.
No, but yeah, you're right, the the 23 degree axis is not from the equator, which is like, I don't understand that why. It is off of the...
No.
Yeah, it is.
Longitude, latitude, longitude is the Tropic of Cancer is a Capricorn, 23 degrees north and south of the equator.
Okay. So if you're on the equator, the line of latitude that you're on is 0 degrees?
Zero. Well, yeah. If the equator is zero, yeah.
Okay, yeah. So for that reason, on Earth, we don't follow this convention. We call this angle phi in that case, right? Because zero degrees phi would put you at the North Pole.
Yeah.
Whereas, and in the lines of latitude, I'm confused, for Earth, 0 degrees latitude would put you down here on the equator. If you imagine like a sphere centered at the origin. So this might be a little different from what you're used to, if you're used to that.
Latitude's the primary radian.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Which I'm not a sailor, so.
Gotcha.
Yes.
But yeah, so there's some governing equations. We want to see, in order to be able to freely move between these three different coordinate systems, right? You want to be able to, there's going to be some equations that are going to help you to get from where you are to where you want to be. And as you can see, if I just look at this plane right here, this triangle in the XY plane, notice that it is indeed a right triangle. That means that x squared plus y squared equals r squared, right? And that's going to be useful anytime you're going from here to here, either way. You can also see that, as before, the tangent of theta is y over x. And again, that'll be useful to go back and forth from here to here. So that's good. Z is Z, so that's going from here to here is easy in that regard.
Yeah.
It is a little trickier going to spherical coordinates, but it does help to notice that's also a right triangle, right? So make sure you have the same, you're seeing what I'm seeing spatially. If you have a point right here, this diagonal distance is rho, and this point is hovering above this shadow right here, which has the same x coordinate, same y coordinate, but the z coordinate is zero instead. That's r, that's rho. And if this is a z axis, the angle from here to there is phi.
Right? It's complementary to the angle on the bottom.
Exactly, yeah. So,
I should've used that one anyway.
That means, then, that
So if you look at this triangle right here, or rather
this rectangle,
right, then I can see there's a relationship between R and rho. Right?
Right.
In fact, actually, since the angle's right here, it might be helpful to label this as R and this as Z. I think what I want to write down will be a little more intuitive if you consider this triangle right here, which is also a right triangle. Right? As you can see, what do I want to say? I guess Z squared plus R squared equals rho squared. And the tangent of phi would be R over Z. Well, this seems more like equations that would be useful to move from I guess you could say spherical to cylindrical and back and forth, right? But if you want to go from spherical to rectangular, right, then, I guess if you want to be a minimalist about this, if you only have so much space on your cheat sheet,
that's what I want to do.
This is all that's needed. Every question can be answered right here, right? This is your bare minimum. I guess actually maybe the bare minimum is just this picture, and then you can come up with these equations, right? But yeah, you know, like for example, you know, as a direct consequence of this, it is, for the sake of speed, it is useful to know that x is equal to r cosine theta, and y is equal to r
sine theta. Which is the big brain on you?
No, because that's like how you do over there.
So it is nice that whatever you can recall from here will be useful here. But if you want to go straight from spherical to rectangular, we do have some equations kind of like that. They're a little bit more complicated though. Notice that the x coordinate, well, let's see here. How do I want to say this? Okay, well, it's r cosine theta, right? But that's not spherical coordinates. But I do know that, what I want to say here, r, notice that r is rho sine phi.
Okay, yeah. It's just hard because it's upside down.
Yeah.
Which again is another relation. Yeah. But yeah, I see it. Yeah.
Rho sine. Okay.
Yeah, see, like, if I take this triangle right here, there's R, there's rho, there's the C, here's phi. And if I turn it around like this,
like normal,
like the way you used to,
normal.
Yeah. Well, this would be Z and this is R. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Maybe in this form it's a little easier to see because the rho is kind of like the R. You know, you can see that R is rho sine.
Yeah.
Right. So that's rho sine V cosine theta. Likewise, by that same substitution, y is rho sine phi I didn't even mention it, but I guess I should have. C equals C. Right?
It's not even worth mentioning, but when it comes to spherical coordinates, you can see that Z, let's see here, Z, that's right here, the side that's adjacent to phi. It's going to be rho cosine phi. It's a little easier to see over here, right? Z is rho cosine. So these equations are more useful, right? Maybe just for the sake of speed, it might be worth jotting these down too. But yeah, so these are especially useful if you're going from spherical to rectangular, right? I guess if you're going from rectangular to spherical, well, you just have to
kind of draw a
picture and figure it out. You know? I mean, I could give you equations, but I think it's easier to just kind of know the governing equations and just put them together the right way. Okay. Well, that's basically the whole section. But I guess I should do some examples. Right? Notice, when it came to rectangular coordinates, there's certain things that are very, very easy to graph. And there's other things that are kind of hard to graph. For example, if I want to graph in rectangular coordinates the plane that's parallel to the xz plane, maybe 2 units over.
That's parallel to the which plane?
Xz. Imagine, like, here's 2 on the y-axis, and here's a plane that's passes the 2 on the y-axis and is parallel to the x and z plane. It's a very simple equation to write.
Y equals 2, right?
Yep. Yeah. So rectangular coordinates is really useful for expressing planes that are parallel to the coordinate planes, right? And each of those comes from just setting x equal to a constant, y equal to a constant, z equal to a constant. One of the things that's a little trickier in rectangular coordinates is graphing a cylinder, let's say.
Yeah, clearly.
But if you're in cylindrical coordinates, as the name implies, it might be relatively easy to graph a cylinder. For example, if you're in cylindrical, ask you to graph r equals 2.
So that means it's a cylinder that's going along the z,
yeah,
with a diameter of 4, I guess.
It's a set of all points in 3 space, where r equals 2, but theta and z can be anything. Right?
Oh yeah, so
degrees.
Yeah, just going up forever, right?
Yeah.
So, I had it right, you confused me with all that smart Tom.
Yeah, so if you're in the x, y plane, let's say, the set of all points, if r is 2, here's a point that's where r is 2. Just right here where it hits the x-axis at 2. There's another one over here. It's also on the y-axis at 2. This also has a radius of 2. And there's lots of other points along here. Right? If I start, keep graphing into the other octants, I'll see the other parts of this circle. That's not all of it. I can pick all these other points because theta can be anything. Right? It could be 0, it could be 30 degrees, 45, whatever you want. And also, because z can be anything.
Yeah.
that.
Now, rulings on that though will go up and down.
Yep.
Parallel to the z-axis.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Exactly. Yeah. And I just drew the portion that's in the first octant, but yeah, if I went to the other octants, it would look something like this. With the understanding that it actually continues down below, continues up infinitely far, right? And so the graph of this is pretty simple, right? We could have written the equation of this over there, but it would have been a little bit more complicated. Not much, but a little more complicated, right? Well, what if I asked you to graph, z equals 2. All right, well, that's pretty much the same thing. R can be anything, theta can be anything, but z needs to be 2.
Just a ring, right? Just a ring around?
No, because R doesn't have to be 2.
It would be a pipe coming out to you.
No.
A rod? So 2.
So just think of a point where z is 2. Just one.
Where?
1, 0, 2.
Oh, okay.
1, 0, 2.
0, 0, 2. That's what I was.
So 0, 0, 2. That means R equals 0. Theta equals 0. But Z equals 2, right?
Right.
Yeah.
So that would be right here on the Z axis, huh?
Yeah, that's what I'm.
It'll be a plane running parallel to the XY plane.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Right? It's the same as what it would have been in rectangular coordinates. How about this one?
It's a plane at that angle.
Right? Yeah. What's the orientation of that plane?
Parallel to the ZX, right?
Mm-hmm. Parallel to what?
Well, I mean the XZ plane.
It would be where?
Sheet running north and south.
No, because it wouldn't be parallel. It'd just be 2. Like, you know, what is 2?
Well, just give me a point that for which theta equals 2.
0, 2, 0.
Okay, so that means R equals 0.
Yeah.
Theta equals 2.
Yeah.
And Z equals 0. Right?
Yeah.
So that means that if R equals 2, that means I'm not departing from the
yeah.
origin at all.
Yeah.
But the angle is equal to 2. And then Z is 0.
Okay, it'd be a sheet coming out from at an angle that looks like the
2.
X equals Y.
Uh-huh.
That goes up and down.
Yeah. So 0, 2, 0 is just the origin, actually.
Right.
So, but yeah, you have to, after you plug in a dozen or so more points, like 0, 2, 1, 0, 2, 2, it gets more interesting when the R radius is something other than 0.
Yeah, 1.
Like 1, 2, 0. Where is that?
Coming out this way.
Yeah, it's in the XY plane because z equals 0. But, and it's a distance of 1 from the origin in the XY plane. So it's on the circle of radius 1. But where on the circle is it?
What was the R? Whatever the R you said was, I forgot what you said.
R was 1, yeah.
So 1.
Yeah. 1, 2, 0, right?
Yeah.
That means
R is 1.
R is 1. Theta is 2. And Z is 0, right?
Right.
Let's interpret, since 2 is an angle, let's interpret that as 2 radians.
Yeah. It would probably have been easier to explain if you had said, like,
something.
Or pi over 2, something that we'd be like, you know, that I don't know what 2 looks like.
Well, we know that it's what, 3.14 radians in a circle?
No,
what? In half a circle.
3.14?
Yeah, pi is half.
So then it'd be more than 90.
Yeah.
So it'd be around.
Oh, like sorry.
110?
Yeah. It'd be somewhere in that.
Yeah.
In this octet behind.
Other octet? Yeah.
Yeah, behind the YZ plane.
Yeah.
There'd be a point right here. Not there, I guess. Right? But of course, D didn't have to be zero.
Maybe.
Right? There's also points up above it. So, what you can see is I'd have to look behind the YZ plane, but there's this plane that's kind of cutting through it. The plane literally contains the Z axis. And if I could see this octant over here, you'd see the plane continue on, cutting through that octant. Right? So, theta is measured from the positive axis in the counterclockwise direction, that is to say towards the positive y-axis.
Okay.
And if theta equals 2, that means it's like you're over here.
Oh, and then everything on the...
Yeah, but you can see how everything on this diagonal plane right here,
yeah,
right, with the because r can be anything.
It can be negative.
The plane goes out forever.
Right.
And because z can be anything, it can go as high as you need to go. Z could even be negative, so it can go as low as you need to go. But it would be a plane, and it would actually be, and if you allow for negative r,
yeah,
it could even cut over into right here. Right? So yeah, so you know, it was really easy to write the equations of coordinate planes as well as planes that were parallel to the coordinate planes. But with cylindrical coordinates, you can write these like other planes a little, with ease. I mean, we could have done it here too, but you know, it would be in terms of slope. You wouldn't be turning in terms of angles, right? So this is a nicer way to go if you're working with angles instead of slopes.
Excuse me.
So yeah, so you can come up with things like this, things like this, things like that, right? And okay. Well, that's kind of nice. And you can even do things like, let's see, what can you do with ease in spherical coordinates?
Spheres.
Yeah.
There you go, you're catching on. Nice.
Oh, these pins are going to
I dropped this pin the other day and the tip it pushed in. Mm-hmm. I'm too cheap to throw it away because it still has ink in it.
Yeah.
Say you bet.
You can't just put that ink cartridge in the middle one.
Yeah. Or you just keep it. Yeah.
I just have to hold it perfectly perpendicular. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Until it goes even further and then I have to throw it away, I guess.
Wow.
But yeah, so like, for example, if I want to graph, rho equals 2.
That's the sphere with the radius of 2.
Yeah, so theta can be anything, v can be anything, but I just want the distance from the origin to be 2. The graph of this would simply be a set of all points that are at a distance of 2 from the origin. A sphere is super easy, right?
Mm-hmm.
There it is. That's the equation of a sphere of radius 2. I didn't tell you how to do it yet, but I think you can figure out how to write the equation of a sphere of radius 3. Right? I'll leave that for you to figure out. We also have, what if theta equals 2? Or what if v equals 2? That is to say, 2 radians. What would the graph? Well, this one, I think the theta in spherical coordinates is the same as the theta in
cylindrical.
Right? That's right, right? Yeah.
Yeah.
So I think you get this one for free. We did the hard work already, right? Since 2 is in the second quadrant, at least in 3 space, you would imagine something like this, right?
Yeah.
Again, it's a plane that contains the z-axis, slices through that back octant over there and this side octant over there. Right? With the understanding that the angle from the positive x-axis to here
like in the XY plane, is two.
Two.
Yeah, radians.
Right.
Okay, okay. How about this one? How about this one?
Would be diagonally up.
Yeah.
Coming up from the whatever quadrant is down.
The octets down there. So the
canted.
So rho can be anything.
Yeah.
Theta can be anything. I only require phi to be exactly two radians.
Oh, well, but then from z, so then that would put it back down in whatever number quadrant that
like
is.
This way.
Yeah. So for example,
it'd be going
if
down
this is the positive z axis right here, and I measure an angle of two radians, that's more than 90 degrees.
Right.
That means you've got to, if you imagine like my elbows here, it's like an angle that goes all the way down below the XY plane.
Oh yeah.
So it's going from up.
Right.
It's going up.
Right.
So it's
going. But theta can be anything. So it, you know, I'm trying to, it's getting awkward, but it's like three dimensional.
Oh wow. Like, okay. So.
Right. And rho can be anything. So it's, you know, if you extend my arm, you know, really far, but allow the angle theta to be anything.
A cone?
Yeah. You're getting a cone here. And if you allow for rho to be negative, then you would have this other half of the cone coming up right here.
So it would be the double inverted cone.
Yeah. So I want to be able to see, I sort of want to see all the octants now. But you can see how you would have this, if rho is negative, you'd actually get the top half of the cone. And if rho is positive, you would get the bottom half of the cone over here. Where the angle from the z-axis all the way down to the bottom cone is two radians.
Dragon.
So spherical coordinates is really useful for spheres, obviously, but it's also useful for cones, right? And this is something that will, if you take multivariable calculus, when you take multivariable calculus.
That's right. When?
It's going to come back, right? And you might have to, you know, look at, maybe you want to find the volume of this ice cream cone. You know, there's the cone part and there's the ice cream part. You know, if given a choice between rectangular coordinates, cylindrical coordinates, and spherical coordinates, right? This spherical might be a good way to go, because this top part is a part of a sphere, and this part is a part of a cone, and I can express those, you know, very easily in spherical coordinates, right? But you know, if you're trying to find the volume of a you know, you got yourself a birthday cake, and everybody takes a slice.
I love cake.
Right? Maybe you'd like to know the volume of this slice right here. That can be done very easily in cylindrical coordinates. Right? Z equals 2, Z equals 0, let's say. R equals 3, maybe. And theta goes from maybe pi over 6 to pi over 2. Right? You know, this would be in spherical coordinates, this might be represented by where rho equals 2 and what phi goes from 0 to pi over 6 or something like that, depending on the angle.
Right. You're talking about for the just the ice cream part?
For the whole thing. The whole thing.
Can you say it again?
Oh, but yeah.
Yeah. So like if you imagine like this is a you have like the it is centered with the tip at the origin. And if I say this is like up here at 2, maybe, and maybe this angle from the axis of symmetry to the edge, maybe that's pi over 6.
Then I can describe the surface of this ice cream cone, right? Not just the ice cream, but the ice cream and the cone itself, with two equations. Rho equals 2 will give me this part of the surface. Theta equals pi over 6, no, not theta, phi equals pi over 6, we described that, and theta can be anything.
So you'll be, I scanned over the exercises. There's a lot of problems where they give you an ordered triple, but then they say this ordered triple is in spherical coordinates. Now put it into rectangular, or vice versa, something like that. Right. Yeah. So you can see how, like, for example, here, cylindrical coordinates. So these are the cylindrical coordinates. That means r equals 4, theta equals pi over 6, z equals 3. What would that be in rectangular coordinates, right? Or here it is in rectangular coordinates. Can you put it in cylindrical, right? Those will feel a lot like polar coordinates. Yeah. Well, yeah, here's something. Here's the equation of a surface here. That looks pretty ugly. Boy, I gotta check. Is that a homework problem? That might actually be a homework problem.
Nah, this is cool. Let's do it.
Looks kind of rough. Must be a homework problem.
I know, right?
Yeah. I keep doing these homework problems by accident. Let's see here. We got assignments here. What is this, week 8? So yeah, 2-7, I guess, 384, 392.
Oh, 384.
That's a good, that was a close call. But yeah, you know, like 382, for example.
Dude, come on. 382, really?
383, maybe?
Yeah.
Even though it's odd?
Yeah.
383, yeah. So like the instructions here say, so that's an equation in 3-space, right?
Right.
At a glance, it's not really clear what it looks like. But let's see if we can write the equation of the surface in rectangular coordinates. So it's given in rectangular coordinates. Find the equation of the surface in cylindrical coordinates, right? So you take 383, for example. That's in rectangular coordinates. But what would that equation be in cylindrical coordinates, right? So like, for example, if I'm going from, yeah, there's a couple things you can do. If you're going from cylindrical to rectangular, right? I know that x squared plus y squared equals r squared. And the way I wrote it down earlier was I said that tangent of theta equals what? Y over x?
Oh.
I kind of just left it at that, just to be a minimalist, right? But, you know, for the sake of speed, it is worth knowing that x is r cosine theta and y is r sine theta. So armed with these four equations, one thing that jumps out at me right away is that x squared plus y squared
is a circle.
That's what I think.
True, yeah.
Well,
I'm just thinking r squared.
If we,
Well,
okay. I was gonna say parameterize it.
Mm-hmm.
And then you eliminate the parameter.
Just need to get rid of x. And I guess I could just say r cosine theta. Done.
Man, it seems so much easier. Like, you're just like, oh, just plug it in here when I said. And I'm like, I don't know, I'm thinking way too hard.
Yeah.
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 What does that look like?
Oh, that's a good question.
I don't know. Let's see here. Yeah. Well, notice it's independent of Z.
Right. So it's going to go forever.
So you could think of it as polar coordinates in the XY plane, and whatever shape you get, you just kind of drag it up with these vertical rulings parallel to the Z axis, right? So.
So what shape is that still?
Yeah, I still don't know. Yeah. Well, yeah. I wonder. Oh, yeah. Oh, okay. Okay, okay, okay. How about this? I don't know. I'm just not as experienced with polar coordinates. I'm much more experienced with rectangular coordinates. When I look at this, here's another way of looking at it. Before we start converting, notice that this is...
X minus awesome ellipse.
Oh.
Half of this squared.
Half
of the square. 8 30 64.
Right. See where that came from?
Okay, yeah.
And
so it's an ellipse. is that an ellipse?
It is. It's an ellipse centered at...
A type of ellipse, also known as a circle.
Centered at -8, 0. Right?
Mm-hmm. +8, 0. With
oh, yeah. Lines.
Oh, because it's a circle, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh, you know what? It might have jumped out at me a little more. I was getting thrown by this extra factor of r. Notice you can rewrite this as r times r minus 16 cosine theta. This is like two graphs in one. It's like r equals 0 and
r minus 16 cosine theta equals 0. Right.
Yeah, you know what I mean? But the graph of this is just a point. And the graph of this would be the circle, right? So, yeah, so I think it jumps out at me a little more when I have it in this form. But yeah, so one way or another, whether it's in rectangular coordinates or in spherical coordinates, there's two different ways of expressing a circle of radius 8 centered at that point right there. And I guess, and technically, that's the x-axis, that means it's centered right here at 8 on the x-axis. It's a circle coming around and actually
touching the
origin, but then coming up like this.
Forever.
Yeah. So this is a circle that is not centered on the z-axis, but centered with the z-axis on the side of the circle, on the side of the cylinder, I should say.
Which side is the side on the cylinder?
I don't know. It only has one side.
One side, yeah.
Yeah. So yeah.
Now hold on.
Oh, there's two sides to the cylinder. Outside, inside.
Right. True.
I'll ask you one day.
Okay.
What's up, dude? It might be a good question.
No, it's 384.
Okay.
Use it the same purpose we did before.
Trying to do that homework. That's what's up, bro.
Yeah, that's true. But, yeah, some of the advice I gave you might come in handy here, like...
Yeah, plug it in.
And the whole point is just to get rid of all the X's and the Y's.
But at least with the crap little R's.
Well, that's okay. You could have stopped here. The question didn't ask you to interpret it. You know what I mean?
Okay.
Or you're just taking it a step further.
Oh, I got 384 then next. Next! 384's done.